So what I want to talk about now are, in this video and the next one, are two, for me, really fascinating areas of music technology. And they particularly fascinate me because of the way they unite this creative practice and this technical pursuit together to create a really a new way of thinking about music and kind of its role in creative in creativity and in the world, for that matter. And so in this video, I want to talk about the practice of soundscape composition. Soundscape composition is essentially a process of going out into a natural environment, recording sounds there, and then using them in a musical composition. And it typically consists of these three stages that are on the slide here. The first one is field recording. So with field recording, you go out with a microphone and a portable audio recorder, and usually headphones, so you can hear very clearly what you're recording. And you spend a lot of time exploring the sounds in a particular environment. That might be a national park, it might be a subway station, any place where you think that the sounds are really interesting and that they have some musical potential if you really kind of focus on them and think about them. So you record all of these sounds in this particular environment. And then stage two, you go back and you really spend some time listening very carefully to what you recorded and what you captured. You reflect on it, and you kind of respond to it and say, you know, what is the musical potential in these sounds? What are these sounds kind of telling me as a musician? And in the third stage, you actually kind of organize those sounds together to create a musical composition that's built out of those sounds. So that involves editing them and kind of splicing them together, often processing them in various ways, and really trying to create something that's your personal take on this environment and the sounds in it, and a kind of consideration of them as music. And so there's a lot of different reasons that musicians turn to this practice of soundscape composition. The first one, of course, is they might just want to create some good music, and this might be a really interesting way for them to do so, to create something they really think is worth sharing and will speak to others musically. The second one is really kind of a documentation perspective, especially with natural environments that may be endangered in some way or another, to go out and to record the sounds there, because that sonic that rich sonic environment might not be available forever. And so, by going and recording it and capturing it and preserving it, they can keep a record of this for future generations of the kind of sonic beauty of this particular environment. And kind of coupled with this, there's often a kind of a political goal associated with soundscape compositions, either an environmental goal to kind of raise awareness of a particular environment and the beauty of it to try to protect it, or sometimes there's also a kind of noise pollution goal, you know, trying to protect areas of our planet from the sounds of industry and of airplanes and cars and all the things that kind of get in the way of us hearing these beautiful natural sounds around us. And so I thought I would share with you an example of a soundscape composition from Bernie Krause. He's been doing field recording for decades, and he has, I thought these stats were really fascinating, he has over 4,500 hours of recordings in his archive. So he's been doing this a lot. And what he does with those recordings is sometimes he makes albums where he has soundscape compositions. He also does a background music for films and other things like that with these. And then he also does sound installations for museums and other organizations where there'll be a kind of continuously running soundtrack in a particular space to evoke a particular environment. And his particular interest for doing this is to really focus on the sonic relationships amongst the various animals that live in a habitat. So he's interested in how they share kind of musical space with each other, how they space out the sounds that they're making to give each other time to each kind of have their say in the environment, and also how their sounds are spread across different frequencies to give them each other kind of space there between low, middle, and high, and so on and so forth. So I find this practice of soundscape composition to be really fascinating in and of itself. But I also decided to bring it up now at the beginning of the course because it ties into so many of the ideas that we'll be exploring over the next six modules. In module one, we'll be looking at some of the details of how we represent sound digitally And that information is very critical as we're understanding how to effectively record sound in the field with digital audio recorders. In module two, we'll be looking at digital audio workstations and how they enable us to edit and transform and manipulate sound. So that's obviously key to this practice of soundscape composition, of taking these field recordings and organizing them and manipulating them to create a soundscape composition. In module three, we'll look at another practice called sampling, where you actually tie different pre-recorded sound files to MIDI messages that you might hit on a musical keyboard or something like that, which is also an interesting way to trigger field recordings and something that Krauss has actually done in his work in the past. We'll delve into digital signal processing in great detail, looking at the algorithms behind some of the effects that we might use when we're processing sounds, including the field recordings that are part of soundscape composition. And in module six, at the beginning, we'll look at a practice called music information retrieval, the algorithmic analysis of audio, to try to learn something about it, understand something about it. And these kinds of algorithms can be very interesting in terms of Krauss's research questions about these sonic relationships amongst animals in the habitat, or even in a more practical way, when you have a database of his size with 4,500 hours of recordings, as a way to automatically analyze those recordings and try to annotate and tag them in different ways so that you can actually try to find what you're looking for more easily.